Pleasure to be here. During my time at Europol for 9 years, I came here very many times to work with the Swedish Ministry of Justice and the Swedish National Police. Always liked coming to Sweden. Lovely people, so much better than those Danish people across the border. And I'm very impressed that Pehr, typical Swede, makes us start at exactly 8 o'clock, in fact, just a minute before. Very impressed. You should work in the EU for 9 years and see what 8 o'clock start really means. It's like more like 8:15, but it's a pleasure to be here. So as Pehr says, I'm here this morning for half an hour or so to talk about financial crime and specifically the challenge we face in tracking down and seizing dirty money, as it's called in the press. What we can do to make sure that our anti-money laundering regime is as effective as possible. During my time at Europol and before that, working almost my whole career until now on intelligence matters, national police matters, combating organized crime and terrorism, I developed some knowledge and experience of how big criminal syndicates and terrorist groups operate, including how they move their money to make money and also to support their criminal or terrorist activities. And at Europol, we were responsible for coordinating tens of thousands of operations each year across 40 countries. In fact, a network of around 1,200 law enforcement agencies on our single intelligence platform, drawn from 40 countries, exchanging operational intelligence every day. We applied very high-end data analytics to that operation in order to identify those cross-border movements of criminals, terrorists, their money, and other illicit commodities. And it gave us this tremendous insight into how the criminal landscape, criminal economy is operating across Europe and indeed beyond as well. And I want to share some of those lessons with you this morning, as I am now doing in my new job as a partner with Deloitte, where I'm helping boards of different companies, particularly in the financial sector, deal with cybercrime and financial crime, sometimes in a common way as well. So the problem of money laundering or criminal finance. 2 years ago at Europol, we studied this quite exhaustively from the hundreds, thousands of cases that we were involved in supporting and many other research material. We issued a report that estimated the size of the criminal economy in Europe is about 120 billion euros. So every year, 120 billion euros of criminal revenue is generated in the EU alone. I thought at the time, and certainly still do now, that those estimates were quite conservative. I suspect it's at least twice that. In the United States, a much more recent report just a few months ago by an academic institution, so an independent report, put the figure of the size of the criminal economy in the United States at $600 billion. Anyway, it's a big number. It's certainly in the hundreds of billions that are generated each year. To give you an illustration of the type of criminal syndicates that are operating in that space now, it's shifted from the days when organized criminals were attempting to launder the money themselves to now utilizing a professional money laundering market. This idea of a crime as a service criminal economy that's developed over the last few years, certainly on the internet with cyber-enabled crime, but also many other fields, that there are specialist providers of a range of different criminal services that are feeding the big criminal syndicates. Sometimes in the field of people smuggling, for example, specialists in recruiting the victims, other specialists in transporting them, others in forging the necessary passports to get them across borders, and a range of other specialists that are laundering the proceeds of that criminal venture. And in the field of money laundering, we'd identified around 400, we think, of the top professional money launderers in Europe. And these people, some of them were non-European nationals. We worked intensively against the Lebanese network of professional money launderers, for example. These are smart people. They know exactly how to get themselves around the financial system, and it sets the bar for us, therefore, in the field of law enforcement, regulation, public authorities, very, very high. We are dealing with smart people who are now professional in the way in which they approach this problem. To give you one illustrative case, a Colombian drug trafficking group importing and selling on the streets of Europe about $1 billion of cocaine a year, right across Europe. And they were this Colombian major Colombian drug trafficking organization were contracting a network of professional money launderers to physically collect the cash from all these different points of Europe, to bring it into a centralized location, and then to launder it, to clean up the flows of money, and to move that $1 billion of cash, of course, which is how drugs are bought on the streets of Europe, and push it back through the regulated system in order that it can come back in a laundered form to the bank accounts of the criminal kingpins in Colombia. Interestingly, they were taking about a 7% cut for that service. So 7% of 1 billion is how this part of the criminal economy works. Some new trends emerging through that and other cases. Cryptocurrencies becoming a bit of a loophole in the system. We're fixing that now, but in large part, the regulation of cryptocurrencies is certainly not the same as it is with the regular financial system, and that has been exploited and is by criminal groups right now. They are laundering money through casinos. It's a typical kind of well-known way of doing it. They are laundering money through the purchase of high-value goods, for example, through underground banking like Hawala, all of these things that we saw in this case and many others as well. But still, 85% of the criminal proceeds in that case, and I think that's a fairly typical amount, was still going through the regular banking system. So when we talk about criminal financing and money laundering, when we see, I was in Canada last week, where British Columbia has now a bit of a scandal in the local newspapers and with the politicians, because somebody from the regulatory authority said just how bad the scandal was of money flowing through the casinos in British Columbia. Now suddenly the whole focus is on casinos. There'll be a new casino regulatory agency, new casino this, new casino that. That's just a drop in the ocean of where the major problem is. It's still actually in the main financial system. Now, when we turn to the sort of effectiveness of that of the regime, and I look at it in a slightly different way from my background, I'm not a regulator by background, so I'm less concerned with the success of the regulations per se. I'm more concerned with what I think always was and should still be the original purpose of our anti-money laundering regime, which is to stop dirty money going through our economy, to catch the bad guys. And when you look at that, what concerns me is that the culture of this regime that we've built over the last 30 or 40 years works on the premise of the success is measured by in compliance terms. Is a bank compliant with the regulations which have been laid down? If it is, green tick, we move on to the next bank. If it's not, we will fine you heavily. And there will be another public scandal. That's how the regime works. Compliance or not. At no point in effective terms does the regime work to test what I think is a more true metric, which is what is the effect of your compliance. You could be 100% compliant and still be very poor at catching or helping to catch dirty money. So I think the metric of the regime has been lost somewhere in the evolution of this compliance-led culture over the last 30 years. The lawyers really have taken over in the system, and I think it's led to I think some kind of myopia. We've lost our true vision for what is right here. Because if we really ran a regime and a performance measurement that tested the effectiveness of it, we would find very, very disturbing results, as indeed our report at Europol did over 2 years ago, We'd identified a criminal economy of 120 billion euros. Europol was also responsible for managing the network of asset recovery offices throughout Europe. So we knew to the penny how much of those criminal revenues were being identified and seized each year. 1.1% of that figure. 1%. In the United States, that report said 600 billion criminal revenues, 0.55% of which is seized each year. United Kingdom, the authorities say, hovering around the 1% figure. I don't know what it is in Sweden or in the Nordics. I expect it to be more or less the same. Very, very low numbers, 1%. And for me, that's quite interesting that we have spent, you know, a mini lifetime of effort across many parts of our community to get this right. And we're only successful by 1%, really? So it's become a case of systemic strategic failure in my view. And it's quite an interesting, it leads to some interesting observations about why that might be the case. When we have a problem like Danske Bank or more recently also in the Netherlands when ING was fined a record amount for the Netherlands of 775 million, you know, the prism through which, the lens through which these incidents are shown are, again, compliance terms. They're fined because they're not compliant. The problem is because they're not compliant and regulators, the press, the media, politicians speak in those terms. Don't get me wrong, in those cases and in other notable ones, there is clearly a problem to be fixed, and a problem it has to be fixed, and the responsibility of the bank is clear in that case. But when you get repeated failures like that in the system, as we do, then at some point somebody's also got to ask the question, but is there a bigger problem to fix here? Are we sure it's not just this or that? Maybe it's a more systemic problem. And when you look at the metrics that I gave you, then it certainly suggests that there is a wider problem here. Now, why is that the case? If you think about the vision 30 or 40 years ago, it's the right one. Follow the money is a cliched term that certainly is one that's dominant in the law enforcement community. So it's the right vision. We should follow the money because that's which will bring us to the heart of a criminal enterprise and allow us, therefore, to hit it where it hurts most. That vision, through a certain political will, has translated itself into certainly plenty of legislation. We're already on now to the fifth anti-money laundering directive in the EU, talking now about the sixth. So we've had a lot of attempts at getting this right in legislative terms. That legislation, in turn, has given rise to regulations, many regulations, many regulators, an army of regulators, of course, that translate that legislation into specific regulatory requirements that are imposed on the banks and indeed tested and scrutinized in a very rigorous form. So it's not as if we don't have an effective regulatory mechanism from that legislation. And then finally, in the banking sector itself, most big banks are, I think, quite responsible. I've worked with over 30 global banks on this issue. I mean, the average standard now is pretty good. Certainly, the issue has been dominant enough for them in terms of harming their reputation, potentially, for example, in terms of the legal requirements that are clearly on them, that even if they were not instinctively inclined to help, they've been fined into doing so. And so there's no real, I think, evidence that there is a sustained problem of commitment, at least, in the banks of getting this right. Indeed, they are themselves collectively employing tens of thousands of financial crime compliance officers to comply with the regulations. Tens of thousands. Depends how you look at it, but the different figures, anything between $20 and $100 billion a year is what it costs the banking industry to comply with these regulations. So we have a lot of legislation, regulation, a big enterprise in implementing those regulations by the banks, and our return on investment of all of that after perfecting it for 30 years is 1%. I actually think the regime itself, the construct of the regime, anti-money regime, is very powerful. It's not that I wouldn't junk this overnight. That's certainly not my point. It's put us into a very strong position by which to observe criminal money flowing through the system. So the control levers are there. It's just that we're not using them smartly enough, in my view. I think that's the concern that I have. And when I look at the challenges and the deficiencies of the regime and how they operate, I think to a certain extent it operates according to a flawed design. Based on the premise that high volume transaction monitoring is the way in which to give us the best chance to identify criminal monies. So we're monitoring them all, but only to catch a few. And we do that because the volumes are so outstandingly high that even with all those resources I talked about, you can only necessarily apply a very thin layer of control across those transactions in the hope that you find some activity of some suspicious activity of financial reporting. And very often, as the figures show, we are missing that. So it's quite a brute force, standardized, highly inflexible way of trying to identify what is on the other side, very smart, enterprising criminal activity. And it's rules-based as well. It's the application of these rules, that the understanding that we can set a sort of standardized view of what a suspicious transaction would look like, and therefore if we draw a hard box around that, we will be able to catch everything. And that gives rise to quite a slow-moving, inflexible, not very dynamic way of dealing with a problem which is changing and evolving nearly every day. I compare it with our control regime on terrorism, and I spent a lot of my career dealing with counter-terrorism issues. And again, it's very interesting that the principles of the design of the control regime on terrorism here in Sweden, across Europe, are very different to how it is in criminal finance. Very different. And that in itself I find interesting, why as a set of public authorities, as a community, we would see two priorities and then decide to apply a control regime that's very, very different. When in the end, actually, you're dealing with a very similar problem of how to identify and combat criminal activity. In the field of terrorism, the idea that you can apply a level of transaction monitoring across every activity, every transaction, is impossible. So in this, the analogy would be, we monitor every citizen in our country according to a thin layer in case some of them show an alert of potential terrorist activity. Apart from the fact that it would be impossible from a civil liberties point of view, the professionals in the counter-terrorist industry have long time ago since worked out that that's not the most effective use of our resources. Instead, we start at the other end, not at the volume end of monitoring everyone. We start by improving our insight into that very small part of the population that generally represent terrorist threats. So it's a much more intelligence-led regime, a smarter use of the collection of data from multiple points, in order therefore to identify that very small subset of the population, and then to throw a control regime narrowly at that 0.5 or 0.05%. And that's much more effective way to do it. And indeed, although the metrics are different, difficult to compare, I guess, to a high academic standard, nonetheless, the effectiveness of that regime seems to be much, much higher. What is interesting, we've even applied this intelligence-led mindset of counterterrorism to the field of terrorist finance. So it's more or less in the same area as criminal finance. We've applied a much more targeted regime, for example, to how law enforcement authorities, intelligence services, may access certain data held in the banking sector. About 8 years ago, I worked on developing and putting in place a landmark piece of legislation between the EU and the United States called the Terrorist Financing Tracking Program. And that allows those authorities to access data held in the banking sector, even that concerning EU citizens, in order to support specific counter-terrorist investigations. Highly controversial piece of legislation at the time. And as a result, the way which the legislation works is it's extremely targeted around, you have to pass a certain threshold of identifying a suspect before you can even interrogate the database. And when you do, it's a very laser-like targeted view on which data you will collect, how long you will use it for, what you will use it for. And that has been much more effective. It has been a highly important instrument in the fight against terrorism in Europe over the last 5 years since we've had the wave of terrorist atrocities. So in regard to terrorist financing, and there are other examples of that, we have decided to apply a much more targeted regime. It's been more effective. It's just that we haven't extended the principles of that towards criminal financing. If I compare it with how the banking sector deals with cybercrime, for example, here, which is a much less regulated space, that might change. There's a more innovative feel to the culture. The people involved are more flexible. They develop monitoring tools in a quicker way, in a smarter way. They change them. They collaborate much more across the industry. They collaborate much more with law enforcement. And in particular, there are many good examples in the banking sector of the fusion of data relating to cybercrime attacks. Fusion within the banks themselves, but also across industry. Some of the best banks in the world are running data fusion hubs, control centers, where they're bringing 20 different information sources from within that bank alone into one single hub for the collection of that data and for the analysis of it in order to generate the right kind of intelligence to detect a problem and respond to it as quickly as possible. Again, very different to how their brothers and sisters are operating in the next department in the field of financial crime, and that's within the same bank. And I'm a strong advocate of the power of big data and data analytics, providing it's done in the right way. The Europol experiment of collecting a lot of data from 1,000 law enforcement agencies and applying data analytics to it transformed our ability to see the real problem of crime and terrorism in Europe. And that resulted into a 6- or 7-fold increase in the amount of operations we were supporting every year over a certain period. Really, that this data-driven approach was hugely important in the end to how Europe has got to grips with terrorism, for example, and other major threats. And I'm always advocating now that all enterprises, not just in the banking sector, should do so much more with the data that they have. And in the field of financial crime, even within that narrow field, I don't see many examples of a single bank fusing all of its KYC, AML type of data, for example. Even that, which is the minimum first step towards how you can use data in a better way, is not being done. And having done that, you know, we should be talking about how we create pathways for creating platforms of sharing that data across different banks. There is now some talk in some countries like the Netherlands about creating a so-called KYC utility, where multiple banks use a single platform to share data about potential new customers and those that might be suspect. But until now, baby steps only towards that. I go a step further and working on I think quite an interesting project right now, which is encouraging banks also within their own enterprise to consider what they can do to bring their cyber fraud and money laundering data together, to stop this silo mentality, these three different data streams that in the end are all connected with a criminal economy that is becoming much more horizontally joined. More and more cases that we're seeing of the same criminal syndicate using a cyber attack to defraud the bank and then laundering the proceeds of that back through the banking system. Absolutely joined up criminal activity across those three lines, and every bank is still separating the way in which they do it. So there is a different kind of solution in the head, which is much more intelligence in design, even within a single bank, but also, I think, across the industry as well. And across all of this, when we talk about data necessarily, we also have to talk about privacy. And indeed, there is part of the problem of the current regulations is that it has the unintended effect of suppressing the free-flowing exchange of information between banks and even with public authorities. I know it wasn't designed for that purpose, but that's how it operates in effect. When Europol identified the top 400 professional money launderers in Europe today, I personally tried to persuade regulators and banking officials of this. We could not even share those names, at least not very easily, with the biggest banks in Europe. I would speak to a chief executive or a chief compliance officer and I say, forget your voluminous reporting and monitoring of 75-year-old women who are trying to move 5,000 euros from one savings account to another. Just take 10% of your compliance resource and interrogate the names on this list. And I guarantee you the productivity yield will be more than 1%. And if we did that across multiple banks, then that really is very powerful. And that's the kind of regime that we need. But we couldn't do that because the regulations made it very difficult to have that kind of free-flowing exchange between law enforcement and the banks, at least at the European level. Privacy, in the end, I think also... banking privacy and secrecy laws sort of... therefore is a drag on that, which I think is a shame. I think there is a way of seeing privacy in a different, more liberalizing way, actually. I also think it's counterintuitive in data privacy terms to have a control regime that monitors everyone to a certain extent. The principles of most data privacy legislation, including GDPR now, rests on the idea of proportionality, that it is lawful under certain circumstances for a public authority or indeed a private institution to collect and use personal data, but according to a very specific purpose that is clearly laid out and identified and for a very specific need. We will collect data to do this, and for Europol that meant we will collect data if we have due cause to suspect the person is involved in criminal activity. We will collect this data about him, not other types, and we will use it only for this purpose. And we will retain it only for as long as we need it. That is a much more targeted, proportionate regime like the one I referred to on terrorist financing, and the one that could be at the heart of a more responsible regime on anti-money laundering, also in terms of data privacy. And also when you do that, I think you begin, therefore, to clean up your data operations, clean up your view of what you're looking at, so you don't collect everything to see nothing because you're blinded. You collect and use only that data that you need. So it becomes a cleaner data set. Cleaner data sets gives rise to more efficient, more effective, quicker digital operations, and also trains the minds of your compliance officers, your data scientists, to be much more precise and sharp in what they're looking for and how they might act. I think there is some progress. In the UK, some of you might have heard of GIMLET, the Joint Money Laundering Intelligence Task Force, started 2 or 3 years ago. It's brought many of the biggest banks in London together with the national agency in the UK for combating organised crime, the NCA. And they sit physically around a table once a week or so to share information about suspicious cases, mainly coming from the police side now. And the police would bring some cases. Those banks involved would then check their databases for those and come back and report suspicious activity reports based on that. And the way in which they've done that to deal with this regulatory challenge in the meantime is to agree with the regulators a kind of safe harbour, specifically within that sort of bubble of that activity and those actors. And the results are highly revealing. They've identified 200 major cases already for further investigation. But based on that exchange in that forum, which is then brought back to then feed the system of transaction monitoring and based on that to report suspicious activity reports. the reporting coming back from that has been seen to be 60 times more valuable than the normal regime. 60. That means that a lead from that forum, has passed the test once it's gone through the system into the Financial Intelligence Unit of being worthy of further investigation at a rate 60 times higher than it would normally. Absolutely proof, albeit in that sort of mini experiment, of how a more top-down, targeted, intelligence-led regime, starting with the idea of who are the bad guys, who should we really be focused on, which is what the police know, bringing it down into the main, in the banking systems in order to throw the control regime at that. And that's, for me, very important. There are versions of that project, that experience in Hong Kong, in Australia, a different kind of approach, but more or less along the same principles, even in the United States as well. So just to wrap up, I think when we see cases of money laundering challenges or money laundering failures in the banking system, I do think there are areas that have to be addressed. And in those cases that we know about, it's not that I'm making any excuse for the banks. I think they seem to have made some mistakes. They need to fix those problems. There's no doubt about that. But I'm always slightly frustrated that is the end of the commentary in public. And it's fairly easy, I think, for a rather more populist reaction in the media and the politicians to say, it's the banks not performing again. Well, that might be part of the story. But actually, we also have to take a step back to think, after 30 years of doing this, and when the performance metrics, at least those that I think are important, are only at 1%, then we also need to think about whether or not we can do this in a better way. Because there is a lot of criminal money, dirty money, that is flowing through the financial system here in Europe and beyond. And I think we We should be smarter about doing something about that in order to improve the performance metric. I think the regulations can be changed. They don't need, I think, revolutionary change. They don't need to be ripped up. They just need to encourage, to open up the pathways for better information sharing across borders as well. I think the idea of public-private partnerships, this task force-style approach, how you can use this UK experience maybe and convert that into a more permanent arrangement, which isn't people coming together once a week to exchange pieces of papers, but actually a systemic way of sharing information spontaneously every day. Can we get to a point where we have law enforcement people and those from the banks and those from regulators in the same room, in one task force that is managing a high-end but very targeted information exchange operation to identify those greatest offenders? I think that would be the most instructive thing that we could do as well. So this is my quick view of how the business of financial crime looks like across Europe. I'm happy again to have had the opportunity to share that with you. And Pehr, back to you in the meantime. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was also very punctual.
Thank you.
So let's do it like this then. The three short comments. Linda, if you can start, and Hanno Sari, and Martin Andersson. And Rob, you can sit down if you want to during those.
Okay.
And then you come back on stage
and can
comment on the comments if you feel like it. And then we'll take the discussion with all of you. So Linda, please, very welcome.
Thank you. Do you want me to stand here or there? Or
anywhere you want to.
So I'm head of the National Intelligence Division at the Swedish Police, and within this division you find the Financial Intelligence Unit in Sweden, Swedish FIU, and also the recently established National Coordinating Unit against Money Laundering and Terrorist Financing, with the task to coordinate 16 Swedish authorities and the Swedish Bar Association. Just in a few minutes, my perspective of the money laundering situation in Sweden. The financial technology, that this is a t- difficult word for me, the financial technological, the fintech development in Sweden has progressed rapidly and will probably continue to do so. And examples of the areas linked to fintech are new payment solutions, platform for digital identification, as well as global trade in blockchain, cryptocurrencies. And I would say that what we mostly see, a common way to laundering money is to transfer them between accounts, often using payment service as a Swish. And finally, the money are being withdrawn in a cash machine, ATM, and handed over to the persons behind the money laundering arrangement. And the holders of the accounts are often young people that are not really aware of that this is a criminal action. And we also see that there are websites where people are being recruited to transfer money through their accounts, and they have no knowledge of whom they are helping. Regarding a predicate offense, IT-related fraud, as we see it, is today one of the fastest growing crime categories. And in many cases, those actors who are behind fraud-based activities are also active in other forms of organized crime. In many cases, it is the same criminal gangs that shoot each other in Sweden that also commit frauds and money laundering. I would say that the police has a very good cooperation with the big banks, and we have meetings on a regular basis when we discuss the latest criminal development, what the police does and what the banks do to prevent fraud and money laundering by technological solutions. And we are aiming to the gimlet, as Mr. Wainwright just mentioned, the British way of cooperating, but we don't have the legislation for that yet. But when it comes to more complex cases of money laundering, Sweden has a lot to learn. For example, the FIU hardly ever receives a suspicious transaction report from the real estate brokers, although we know that real estates are being used for money laundering. We wonder why, but probably the main reason why brokers don't report suspicious transactions is probably because they don't know what to look for. So the National Coordinating Unit is therefore working on an information campaign to real estate brokers. We really need to improve the skills and knowledge and understanding. We know that later on this spring, the National Coordinating Unit will present its first national risk assessment of the Swedish regime. And we know that Sweden has a lot to learn about combating money laundering, but it is a topic that it is more and more common on our agenda. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you. Great.
Right, I'm Hannu Saari and the global head of Handelsbanken's financial crime prevention department, and representing the financial sector, I suppose, here in this meeting. Handelsbanken, as you most of you know, is a very decentralized bank, and as a banker starting my career in the 80s, mid 80s already, so I've been through the journey when you weren't fit for the branch if you didn't give good advice for your customers. And we were also the early adapters of the IT. Already in the 60s, the big banks tried to do the things the intelligent way and use the technologies which were there already. So that's why the infrastructure is very fragmented. And when we suddenly got the new legislations, I think the third money laundering directive was the thing which really put the world around, so to speak, in the financial sector. And we tried to change the way of thinking, and it doesn't go overnight because of the history. The service, the customer comes first, and you try to serve the customers. The thinking of suddenly being part of a police work it's challenging mentally. But I think most of the banks, I would say all the banks more or less have gone through that journey and are very, very committed, as you said, Mr. Wainwright, that you, the banks you have met are very committed to combat crime. And I would underline all the banks I've met, not only our bank, are very committed to do that. But it takes time because the infrastructure is built for something else. And the data is very fragmented. It's not gathered for this purpose. And we need to build up a new kind of infrastructure. And at the same time, when we have very pushing legislation and always also the authorities and the compliance-led view, that will be the priority for us to build the new infrastructure. And so I very much would welcome more open cooperation with the authority side and even between the banks and share the information, build something broader than this, think bigger. Because even if we put all the data we have within our bank together, it's not enough. We can find some local small criminals, but probably not the 400 big ones you're talking about. They are very intelligent and they work so professionally, so the transaction monitoring will never find them. You need really to know your customer, and you need to have deep intelligence to do that. We are working by the Church Tower principle, as most of you know, and try to know our customers, but it's not 100%, and you can't know all the customers that deep. And as Linda told, the youngsters are new customers for banks. You can know their parents, but you don't know the 16-year thoroughly enough. So you need to have the intelligence for all customers in that sense. Otherwise, we are not getting the criminals for sure. We can be compliant, sure. And I listened 3 hours the hearing in the parliament of the Danske whistleblower. And the CEO were also there, and the impression I got was that they were very, very much compliant. They filed SARs. They even offboarded the customers. But the day after they opened the new customers for the same Vladimir, it's a new limited company coming in the same branch and open the company. So in paper it looks that Danske Estland was compliant. So that's very much my take in this. I was very happy to hear your thoughts and the real goal to catch the criminals and what to do. I also can believe that we have a little bit lost the goal when trying to be, I would say, over ambitious with the compliance. We need to be very ambitious with the compliance, and we need to have all the control mechanisms in place. But we don't get there if we don't have the total intelligence.
Thank you.
Thank you. A couple of small reflections in listening to this discussion, and I think it was a very interesting perspective you gave there, sir, on what you have experienced there. And you talked about the compliance culture quite a bit, and as an old regulator, of course, I need to reflect a little bit on that myself. And actually, it goes back also to what Hanuja said about the commitment that is there in the banking sector, because I can see that now. But I stopped as a chief regulator in this country in 2015, and still, at that time, I had discussion with senior bankers in boardrooms of major banks in this country, where it all was about basically me forcing them to harass their customers. And I think that mentality hasn't been helpful at all in the banking sector. It hasn't been to stop money laundering. It hasn't been about stopping or making it more difficult to do criminal activity. It's about a regulator forcing us to build up a compliance machine that inherently is something bad for our business because it makes our customers annoyed with us. So it is a big shift that has started now, but it started very, very late. And I think this is an important part because it's also been that another aspect of that is the complacency of the Nordics. We are the good guys. We don't have this problem. This is other countries' problem. And that's also a reason why we were very, very late on the ball in this game. We started way later than the others, and you can see that from FATF investigation in the Nordic country. We are all beaten up, and we should be beaten up because we have been very bad at this. So, and I think there is a changing there. There is a stronger commitment. I think with banks still struggling with this, as you say, intelligence-led approach, because they don't really know what to do it, partly because of us as old regulators. It's been this, we can't really articulate what we're after. We often talk when you try to steer a risk in a bank, talk about risk appetite. And you can set an appetite on your market risk or all your financial risk, you can set an appetite. But how do you pronounce or formulate the risk appetite for something like anti-terrorist funding? Will you go up to your board and say, okay, we'll be fine with financing one terrorist attack a year. Can you sign off this, please? That's the last day in that bank for you. And the thing is, banks pretend that there is a zero tolerance. The regulator pretends that there is a zero tolerance, and if you find something there, you get really upset, and politicians pretend. And as long as we pretend that there is zero tolerance, it's very difficult to have an intelligence-led approach, because if you have that, if you have a real risk framework, it means that you say, okay, these things, just skip them, because that's not the real stuff. So chasing those that use Swish and ATMs, that's a small peanuts part of it. It's a big money. The big criminal network is something completely different. And there you need to have much more advanced methods. There is a lot you can do with data analytics. A lot we see in the bank in this part of the world is very, very manual. It's extremely limited what you can do. You use transaction monitoring. You run different scenarios. But given this is extremely intelligent people on the other side, it's not really how to catch it. It needs to be developed much more advanced analytics in there. But I also think that we need to find new way of cooperation. It's enormous lot of waste of resources that each bank do their own KYC of the same kind of customers. We see in some countries, Netherlands is one example, Spain is another, there are a couple of other areas. There is an initiative in Sweden to have a sort of a KYC utility, for example. But also to share, there are limits on privacy and others that limits the possibility to share information, but that's where we need to go. And the UK is a good example where you have a cooperation between private sector and the authorities. We see that coming in other countries in very, very small steps right now, which is interesting because we can't even cooperate solidly on the national level. At the same time, we know that this is an international problem. So you really need to work on it, an international problem. And one reflection that I have had several times is that over 10 years ago, we decided that we needed to have a European transaction reporting system for securities transaction to sort of find ways to see market manipulation. So we have collected that on a European level. And everything is down in Paris, where you can sort of check around with the data, because you realize if you really want to do market manipulation, you won't go via one exchange, you use several. But still, after we have done that for over 10 years. But for this problem, that is so much more damaging for the countries, for the economy, for the general public, we still haven't started that kind of dialogue. That would be much more important, because you need to go into the networks. You need to see the flows in much more advance. It's very limited that one bank can do. If you start working with it in one country, you can do much more. But it's really on the international level that we need to build this out. And we have learned that in other cases that are perhaps less detrimental for the economy. But in this case, we haven't, which is a little bit of a conundrum. And I don't see that discussion going on right now either. There are discussions about a European regulator for this, but that's only one limited part of the problem. So, thank you.
Thank you. Yes, you may sit. Any comments to the It sounds like you agree on a lot of things to me.
Mostly, yes. no, I think it's a very good point. I didn't know about that. The European securities and the market manipulation is a very good analogy about why. So it is possible in the regulations. It is possible in the EU framework to do that. It's just we haven't done it in perhaps an even more important area. Martin's other point about difficulty setting a risk appetite. I think terrorism is always a special case in so many public policy respects. It is indeed difficult to say we will tolerate one terrorist attack a year. Of course not. However, I think on criminal financing, and Linda and my former colleagues, I'm sure, would agree, is that the police are having to make difficult decisions every day on priorities. They effectively follow a risk appetite. And more are intelligence-led in doing that. So Linda doesn't have the resources, I'm sure, to investigate every financial crime, every economic crime in Sweden, but she is smart enough to follow those that will cause the most harm. She effectively is following a risk appetite. And I think there are examples of how we've managed to apply a control regime like that, a risk appetite regime in the law enforcement sector, and I think it should be possible. I hope it could be possible here as well. Of course, it's still difficult for a police commissioner or the politician, the minister behind, to admit that openly. Yes, we are not investigating house burglaries anymore because we're too busy investigating major drugs importation. Of course, that doesn't happen. But effectively, on a day-to-day basis, those decisions on priorities are being made every day. And Hanno's point, I think, is good to hear. I think there is a stronger commitment. I understand that maybe you're still hearing that in 2015. I don't hear much more of that now, I don't think. So I would agree that I think there's a sense of commitment is greater, but also a sense of deep frustration, I think, amongst community that Hannah works in, I think, that I listen to when I'm speaking to all these banks. A common view is it's not so much that you're trying to force us to get tough on our customers. That doesn't seem to be the view anymore. It seems to be that we're spending a lot of money to manage these regulations, and that's okay. It would be even better if we knew that we were doing that because it was effective. Because they know the figures that I have just given. They know that. And they know that they're having to employ tens of thousands of compliance officers to be 1% effective. Where else in their business enterprise would they accept a return on investment on that? Where else? So absolutely they're frustrated by it. And they find it very difficult to continue to recruit and continue to employ the people who are working there, who also know these figures, who are also being told that 95% of what you're reporting to the Financial Intelligence Unit is junk. Those are the figures. So I think it's in many ways, it's quite a difficult regime to manage, I think, within the banking sector, and the regulations could still be tweaked, I think, according to the example that Martin gave.
Okay, we have 20 minutes. This is your opportunity to voice opinions or ask questions on money laundering. Yes. Yeah, you need a microphone then. Please tell us. I know who you are, but...
thanks for a very interesting presentation. I would like to hear a little bit more about this information sharing and your views on the hurdles or restrictions on that. Where do you see... what's preventing that from happening? To what extent is that laws and regulations, and to what extent is it behavior and practices and what we are sort of used to do?
Could I add an angle on that?
Sure.
You both stressed the importance of information sharing in Europe.
Yeah.
Sort of, will Brexit be a problem in this dimension too, or won't it matter?
Yeah.
Or sort of, London is, after all, a very important financial center in this respect.
Yeah, I was hoping to do at least one panel this year, which Brexit wouldn't have been a question. I'm still waiting. Okay, I'll talk about Brexit. I'll come back to that in a minute, Pehr. But I think, so it's a combination of those things. I think the regulations don't help because they restrict, I think, in practical form, the ability to, certainly to share data across borders. And even within a single bank, as we know, to collect and exchange bank customer data between customers in different jurisdictions, but within the same bank, even that is difficult. And sharing it within the community of multiple banks is also locked down to a certain extent by privacy issues. But and that maybe has given rise to a culture of inhibition towards sharing as well. So even where the regulations don't specifically prohibit it, the regime doesn't operate with this mindset. And if you the banks also complain a lot about very, very poor feedback from the FIUs towards them. I don't comment about the situation in Sweden, but and I don't necessarily immediately accept that the banks are right, but when I hear it from 30 banks saying the same thing in different countries, then there's probably at least some truth to it. So the feedback, and maybe it's going in both ways, but the actual information sharing between FIUs and the banks is a problem, absolutely. And that may be fair to the FIUs, if they're getting 95% junk, then, you know, they're too busy doing real stuff, really. But the banks would say, if only you fed back which are the things that you really want and really interesting, even that would be helpful. What we were able to do at Europol was to work with the Institute of International Finance with about 20 global banks that came together through the IIF. I brought the law enforcement community on our side, and we began to have these meetings where we couldn't share actual operational data because of privacy reasons, but we could at least share typologies. So from the 1,000 cases that Europol was seeing, these were the trends. These are the types of the way in which Linda gave the example of the way in which monies are being moved through Mule accounts at the moment. They're doing it in this type of way or in these locations, and typically it's a 21-year-old customer doing, you know, whatever. But these kind of typologies, which we could identify, and more important ones than that as well, about how the big professional money launderers were doing it, and that was taken by those 20 global banks, and that was helped to fed the way in which the rules were set around the control regime of transaction monitoring. And even that had a big impact. If you could go even further and give names of suspects, as well as not just types of how they operate, that would be 10 times more powerful. But it is possible to do that. If you can create an environment, a permissive environment in regulations, if you can create the kind of cultural leadership to encourage that information sharing.
And Brexit?
Oh. Wasn't going to let me. There is no, it's a serious point. I think Brexit has implications for certainly information sharing across all of these areas, terrorism, money laundering, and so on. Because what we learned in Europe was that over the last 10 years, we've seen how big crime, big terrorism has become more and more transnational, and it's pretty obvious. But the more we looked at it, the more we could see multiple international links between every major crime. Even in Sweden, house burglaries, car thefts, for example, are being committed very often by offenders that are coming from other jurisdictions now. It's very much a change to how it used to be. So there is an intrinsic cross-border dimension to nearly all crimes, certainly all major crimes, and that has led to the need in the EU to create an infrastructure that can facilitate the best possible cross-border response, and at the heart of that is data sharing, because it's data that can take you to where you should go. So in the EU, we've created the Schengen Information System, the largest security database in Europe, created more specialized data systems like PRIM or Criminal Records System, and we created at Europol a a more of an intelligence system around the top offenders. And the UK has been a major architect of a lot of that. That's the ironic thing. It's been driving the bus, not only sitting on the bus. And I think is feeding even today a lot of the data going into that. So clearly we have to, and I've given evidence in British Parliament about this, we have to arrive at a deal on Brexit finally that has a responsible security component as well. And we still don't know what that deal will look like. I'm still hopeful, even at this late stage, because I know that people on both sides, Theresa May, certainly she was the former Home Secretary, they understand the importance of this. So I think a regime will finally be found, but we're still waiting to see the details.
Okay. Sorry about mentioning Brexit. Mm-hmm. Please.
My name is Katarina Ringborg. I'm vice chair of the Stockholm-based think tank Global Youth Morning. I have a question to the two Martins. In your general observations being done in your work, do you see any correlation between those problems and the size of a bank in the system?
Only in terms of scale, I think. Obviously, the bigger the bank, the more the more financial transactions, the more overall amount of criminal money might be going through it. I don't think that there is a correlation between necessarily how money launderers would choose to target, I think, banks. Some evidence that smaller banks in jurisdictions that are perceived to have weaker controls, normally outside Europe, some evidence that they would maybe, you know, at least do the initial placing of criminal money at that stage, I guess. But in Europe, I don't see a major correlation between, you know, a mega bank and a regional bank in a certain country. Not that I've seen, but I think maybe Linda or others might be have a more expert view on that.
Okay, I don't see any more hands right now. One question or two, maybe. If you look, say, 5 to 10 years into the future, so what would be your preferred scenario? How should we deal with these questions? And the second part, if we succeed in preventing money laundering through the banking system. You said that the kingpins, is that the word, the drug dealers, are prepared to pay 7% of their surplus to launder the money. I mean, that's a profitable business. And I guess it will flow in other ways if we manage to prevent this. So what are the cryptocurrencies? Is that an alternative way of doing it? And just your thoughts on forward.
I'm an optimist. You know, you can't deal with the worst aspects of human affairs during your career and give in to that. So I like to think that over the next 5 to 10 years, we will find the sort of political will, and I don't mean only from the politicians, but the political will to change this, to stand up as a community, as a society, led by our political leaders and say, you know, we will not allow so much dirty money to go through our economies. This will not happen. We are going to fix this. And we are serious about fixing that. And if we can bring that kind of commitment and energy that we have done to doing a pretty good job of fixing so-called terrorist financing, if we can bring those dimensions towards criminal financing, which is a much bigger scale problem, then I think we can, and do the kind of things that we've been talking this morning about improving information sharing, this task force type arrangement between law enforcement, I think it will have a huge effect. Because if you think about it...
But will it make the criminal activities more difficult? Will it sort of reduce?
Yeah, I think it will. I think there is a chance that the criminals will pivot to more and more to real estate, which I agree with Linda is a problem. Cryptocurrency is another new technologies, but as I said, Pehr, 85% of the problem is here.
Yeah.
Now, if you think about that, if you have material gains in this area, this is where you will have the biggest impact. And it cannot be easily replaced overnight. But then shifting all of that suddenly to cryptocurrencies, particularly if you bring cryptocurrencies within the same regulatory regime as well. And then the impact is pretty obvious. At the moment, my concern is that most of the effort in the industry around this is aimed at making our transaction monitoring capability even better. So we are betting our money now on AI, for example, which still hasn't really delivered. It has a lot of potential, but it still hasn't delivered, I don't think. The idea that AI rules can improve transaction monitoring, that's the solution now. Well, frankly, even if we get the best AI capability on the market and apply it, and we make our transaction monitoring rules twice as effective, even if we reach this level of ambition, we're only seizing 2% of assets now. I want to go from 1 to 10 or 20%, and that's therefore a reconfiguration of the system. And if we do that, if we go to 10 or 20%, it has a material impact. It generates a lot more, takes a lot more criminal money out of the system to stop it circulating. And it does act as a disincentive. At the moment, these professional money launderers are going to those Colombian kingpins and saying, give me all your cash, as much as you've got, because I've got a 99% success rate of getting it through the system. That's effectively what the figures mean. And 1% is not even a cost of doing business for these guys. It's just a rounding error. It is. I want to get it into their head that it's now 10% or 20%. And then it starts to have a serious impact on people and their willingness or their appetite to invest dirty money in our economies.
So you mean that this is not only fighting money laundering, it's fighting the underlying criminal activity, basically?
Absolutely. It's what, you know, money is what makes the criminal world go round, as well as everything else. Absolutely.
Sure. Did I see another hand? Yes. Microphone coming.
Yes, thanks for an interesting presentation and discussion. Lars Weigel at EY. I was wondering, this 1%, which I actually didn't, is very, very low. I mean, is this, in your view, is this sort of a failure of the law enforcement agencies, or you know, the problem with privacy, or failure of the banks? I mean, seems such a low success rate. What is the main, or is it the what in your view is the main
yeah,
reason?
I think,
for
I mean,
the low percentage.
Yeah, keep going, because it's all of those things and a few more. That's my point. I think the regime, the system that we have developed has not been orchestrated in the right way. And it is a point of orchestration, because it depends on everyone playing in the band in the right way. But first you have to have the conductor and the right music sheet. And at the moment we don't. So I think we have the capabilities in law enforcement to... So there are problems in each jurisdiction. In law enforcement, I think not enough attention, not enough resources are allocated in this area. And that's because police have generally quite a hard... The police chiefs find it very difficult to choose between fighting terrorism today, money laundering tomorrow, and so on. But generally, there are not enough, for example, forensic analysts in the police in this field. There is not enough attention in this area. But when they do get their act together, when they operate on a European level, they get the kind of intelligence which can make a lot of difference. But then the regulatory regime prevents them from really doing that. We don't have the connection of feedback that we should have, and so it goes.
We have time for one last question.
Have you considered what this regulatory regime should be replaced with? Should it be outcome-based or principle-based? What would be most efficient in your view?
Yes, I'm not sure about replacing it either. I think about, you know, modifying it and that the test should be more than just are you compliant with the rules. There has to be, I think, also a regulatory test of the system. And these figures which we arrived at, we're at Europol, we are satisfied that we were satisfied about the veracity of these figures, and they've since been more or less validated by many others. So I'm pretty sure that's about right. But the regulatory regime is not itself testing that. Is not doing that. And I think the performance metric therefore could be changed in order to test what the effectiveness of the regime is. And I think, as I said, in the technical design of the regulations, they should also be changed according to the need for better information sharing. And we had the example, I think, from Martin around how you can do it at the European level, for example. It was very disappointing that in the construct of the fifth anti-money laundering directive, we were working very hard on the idea that to fix the problem that we had, can't exchange 400 names with the banks, we should create, alongside the National Financial Intelligence Unit, create a European FIU, which is not dissimilar to what Martin was saying. Create a European FIU to also be a gateway, not instead of, but in addition, a 29th FIU in Europe. And it was blocked by the member states. And I'm sure there are other arguments why, but essentially we missed an opportunity to do that. So simple changes like that, to open a gateway, because that would allow, because Europol, for example, is already collecting the data on a European-wide basis, already has the processed data for other reasons. Now, just open a door to allow that to go into this system would mean such a simple but effective way of doing it, and we missed that trick.
Okay, we have two more minutes. I want to use every minute we have you here on stage. We talked primarily about Europe, or almost exclusively about Europe. Is there any sort of global cooperation? I guess the problems exist in other parts of the world.
Yeah, as I said, I think in Hong Kong, in Singapore, in Australia, we have now also very interesting models of information sharing, pilots. In the US, it's been driven primarily through the Patriot Act and the need to do more on terrorism. But it kind of works to a certain extent. But nonetheless, the performance figures are still the same. Mm. Okay. So it's a systemic problem which stems from the regime as a whole, which applies global standards. And that's what needs to be fixed.
Okay, now we have run out of time. Thank you very much for coming here. We appreciated it a lot, and we did learn a lot, and we hope you may come back sometime.
Okay, thanks, Ben.
Thank you very much.